Namaste everyone. Management education, as we all believe, is at the crossroad. And in this era, if you recollect my last module, I talked about one American professor who gave a term called as VUCA. His name is Johansson. That was in 2013. And then we have at Banasthali Vidyapeet stretched this model, and we have come up with a concept called as VUCA NW. So while the VUCA stands for volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity, the NW, two more components that we have added. N stands for the natural apathy, and W stands for wisdomlessness. So we are into that era, which I would say that in much better way has been compiled by our ancient scriptures as a term called as Kalyug. Now, at the same time, it is widely believed that the management institutes, which are typically addressed as the B schools, should foster consciousness among the students. So they should become the C schools, that is the consciousness schools. And in the time to come, they can become even the D schools, that is the divine schools. And this is in consonance with our Indian traditions. Now, in this backdrop, the question is that what we in the management institutes can do in the terms of specializations. Now, specializations which are offered by the different management institutes typically are finance and banking, marketing management, HRD, production, and a few more. Now, the question is that how do we innovate within these specializations? That is A. And B is that what new specializations can we think of? So, in view of the emerging specializations that we can think about in management education and think about the curriculum and preparing the students, etc. So, in this backdrop, we have with us two experts, Dr. Ankur Joshi. His area is public policy and CSR, and he would throw the light about the aspects in this domain and what way the students can be groomed by we as the management teachers. And we also have with us Ms. Ankita Parikh, whose area is aviation management. She is an aviation expert. And she is herself MBA aviation, as you know that there are very few MBA aviation in India. So in that, we are going to discuss about three specializations. One is the sports management, which I would try to cover. And the second is public policy and CSR, which Dr. Ankur Joshi would cover. So first of all, I would request Dr. Ankur Joshi to throw his views on the public policy and CSR as the specialization.
We might have heard the word of famous quotation of Henry David Thoreau, who said that government is best which governs the least.
Yeah.
He said this about 150 years ago, but this is more relevant in today's time when governments have realized that their business is not to do business. Therefore, they involve stakeholders in contributing to development of the nation. The recent developments in India are leading to transition in political scenario, social scenario, economic scenario. We can observe that services which were once considered to be monopoly of government are now witnessing fierce competition amongst corporate. Best examples are telecom industry and aviation industry. The government is more open to outsourcing, disinvestment and public-private partnership models. So it is natural that the matters pertaining to policymaking, law and governance are becoming crucial for all sectors including the corporate. In this backdrop, corporate have started hiring candidates who possess the knowledge of law, public policy and management. At the same time, the need for ethics and good governance are gaining importance. And thus organizations need to ensure that their activities are in consonance with the rules and regulations of the country in which they operate. All the dimensions ranging from fair treatment towards customers, employees, competitors, collaborators, environmental responsibility, social responsibility have become more and more relevant.
No organization can afford to remain insensitive towards these areas. The need for a dedicated team who takes care of these special aspects of business is essential. So, again, the organization vouch for such candidates who can be useful asset for them.
So, Ankurji, what do you think? What kind of courses can be taught in B school to prepare the student for the emerging areas or job opportunities?
Yes, very pertinent question, Ankita ji. We have witnessed a crucial paradigm shift from public administration to public management and to public governance. So, the knowledge of understanding of policy research, policy implementation, public governance, regulatory framework, business affairs, corporate governance, social entrepreneurship, etc., could be very useful for the candidates. It is needless to mention that sound understanding of management courses like marketing, finance, HR also. Otherwise, it would be irrelevant to teach the policy courses. The candidates can focus and derive something useful from the above mentioned courses.
So, I think that what points Dr. Ankur has mentioned, they are very relevant. And we can also consider one important development that has happened is that now a 2% CSR is mandatory for a certain set of companies out of the net profit that they earn. Now, in this backdrop, what's happening is that a large number of corporate, they are working on the social issues and they want people who are trained. And unfortunately, since it was not taken up in such a professional way in India, so what has happened is that on account of that, there is a lack of qualified professionals who can look at the CSR and the public policy with a managerial angle. And what I find usually is that a lot of students who have done MBA HR, they have query that how they can come into the field of public policy and CSR. And if you look at the corporate, you will find that most of the people who are in the CSR domain, they are from the HR. So if the management institutes are offering the HR specialization, why don't they also offer the public policy and CSR along with that? So if they offer, then that could be an advantage. Say, for example, HDFC Bank, they do a lot of projects, if you see, in the domain of CSR. Now, if they have people who are from HR, they understand about CSR, then I think they will be very interested in hiring. Similarly, the PSUs also, they would find it very interesting that they have some choice available where people have HR specialization and public policy and CSR. So, in this context, this public policy and CSR, I'm pretty sure that in the time to come is going to get very popular. But the question is that we as the management institutes, are we prepared? Would we like to think about offering this to our students? Now, after this public policy and CSR that Dr. Ankur has spoken about, I would also like to mention about one more emerging segment, and that is sports management. Sports management has caught attention in India recently, and I think everyone knows that, you know, cricket, which was so formal, now we have a format called as the IPL, Indian Premier League, which is getting so popular. And if you see the global context, however, in 2014, KPMG came up with a report. They said that about $700 billion, that's what is the sports market worldwide. So now the market definitely should be much more. And even on a conservative estimate, you can say that the market must be $800 billion plus market. We are talking about the global market right now. And if you see this figure, $800 billion or so, it's close to 1% of the global GDP. So now the context is that if it is just about 1% of the global GDP and we find more and more people getting interested in sports, just imagine what will happen if in the next 5 years we have sports contributing to 2% of GDP. So that would mean the market would double in a few years. Now, if the market doubles or it has the potential of doubling, then there is a big role that the management professionals can play. So, sports management is yet another area which we in management institutes can think about adding a specialization, or we can think about an add-on program on sports management. When you see the aspect as to why this sports management is bound to grow, then the first thing is that the interest among the people about sports is growing. See, why IPL has become popular? Why the pro kabaddi is coming? Why the pro badminton is getting popular? So these all things are showing that the trend is such that there is a crave among the people that, okay, sports in some or the other way we would like to associate. Second thing is that the globalization that is happening. So nowadays you will find that the kids are also sometimes talking about the NBA at the US. And in the era of globalization, we find that a cricket match is being played between Pakistan and Australia or Pakistan and New Zealand, and the venue is neither Pakistan nor New Zealand, it is in UAE. So there is a globalization that is happening, and there is a good amount of business that's there, and which students and all, if they specialize into sports management, can avail themselves of that opportunity. The third thing is that the sports startups like Smash or Proline, they are all, you know, coming up, and one more is Kalo, and so these are coming up, and they are trying to rewrite the rules of the game. They are into the disruption. They are disrupting the market. But on the other side, so many new ideas that are going to come up. And through that, the business is growing. You know, people are linking up the things which nobody had thought before. And so sports startups is also one factor that's going to contribute to the growth of the industry. One more thing that's happening is that the competition is hitting. The competition is growing between the companies which are offering something or the other, whether it is the apparel or whether it is the event management. So they are competing more. Since they are competing more, they are improving, the business is growing, and they see the opportunities which are there across India as well as outside India. So, you cannot leave yourself uninterested from the sports management. And finally, I would say this is the best thing that's happening for the sports management, that is the institutional infrastructure and the mechanism and the government support is becoming better. So you will find that the associations which are there for the various sports, they are much more active today. The government is keen that, government has identified, not just in India, but abroad also, that sports is linked to the tourism part also. And as a result of that, there are going to be a lot of opportunities in the time to come. Look at what has happened in Qatar. Qatar, since hosting the FIFA World Cup. So Qatar, the government is seeing football not just as a means why they can support the football tournament in Qatar, but they are also seeing that with that the tourism is going to go up, not only just during the football tournament but even after that. So sports management, that's why it's quite into limelight. In the context of India, we would say that cricket still dominates. So since cricket accounts still for about 60% of the total business as far as the sports management in India is concerned, that's fine. One can join that league in some form or the other, but the other segments are also growing. While one can always say that sports is quite equivalent to cricket in India, in the sense that, if you see the Vivo IPL rights, then from 2018 to 22, Vivo has paid about 2200 crore rupees for this. But apart from that, others are also emerging. If I recollect one of the bright bonus slides, I spoke to Dr. Sunita Godara, who was the first woman to be the Asian gold medalist in the marathon. So she mentioned that the marathon is quite getting popular in India, and she finds that, we have marathon going on in Bangalore and Delhi and Mumbai Marathon and so on. And there are so many opportunities, but at the same end, she feels that there is lack of quality professionals who can do even better. And this is shared by one more of one slide, Dr. Benu Agarwal Gupta, who is right now the part of the boxing tournament that is taking place in Delhi. And she also feels that, in the time to come, we require people, management professionals, who have specialization in sports management. So that way, we can say that the opportunities are immense in the area of sports management.
Sir, so what are those aspects on which the students can be trained for their promising career in sports management?
So when it comes to the field of sports management, then I would say that your question is quite relevant. And we as the management teachers would always like that our students should excel. And in case they are going for sports management, then this question needs to be answered. And so as I think the students are very keen to know about when we discuss anything about sports management with them as to what is in for them. So I would like to tell a few things in this regard. The first is that the way in which the overall grooming of the student is going to take place. So there I have a model that I call as the COIN model, C-O-I-N. Now C stands for character and conceptual ability, wherein we have to remember that our first goal is that we should build up the right attitude for sports, and along with that the concepts in sports management are something that we need to acquainten the student with. The second aspect, that is the O stands for opportunities. So we need to tell the students the kind of opportunities that are there in the market so that they are inspired to do and act accordingly. And also on the our part, on the opportunity part, we need to give the kind of opportunities to the students. For example, if you want your student should do well in sports management, why don't we call some sports personalities or people who are from the sports companies to the campus and ask them to interact with the students? And at the same time, we try that some of the people who are associated with sports, they specifically mentor our students. So if they are mentoring the student, then slowly they are going to have a good networking, and through that the student is going to get benefit in the time to come. The third thing, that is the I, is the internship part. So we teach the students about sports management, but that is not sufficient. They must get their first break in sports management. It could be an event management company, it could be like say right now if you see the boxing event that is taking place in Delhi, there are so many students that volunteer and they say that make us a part. Similarly, the Pro Badminton League that is going to come up from 22nd December onward, now some people can be associated with that. So that is internship, but that's a smaller one. But apart from that, you know, in the summer break or the summer internship or the projects that the students do, or even otherwise the projects which are there, like say in marketing, if there is a project, if that project is linked to sports, then that's going to benefit the students. So other teachers also should know that they can try to cater to the interest of the student. And the last one, that is N. N stands for networking. So the student needs to network herself well with the relevant organizations in sports, because remember that MBA sports management might be offered by very few in India. So thereby the kind of formal interface and the ecosystem that you have maybe for the general marketing, finance and banking, that may not exist in sports management. That may be a limitation, but that may also be an opportunity. So through this COIN, C-O-I-N, COIN, I think that is the way in which the students can be groomed up. Second is the kind of career. So you can find careers in the field of event management. And when we have events like IPL and the Pro Kabaddi and others taking place, then they require people and they pay very well. So there are companies that specialize in that and they are looking for people who are well trained. Third thing is the marketing and advertisement and the analytics. So that is also a segment where the students can groom themselves. I would say that for that, what we need to teach students and our curriculum that has to be developed very well in consultation with the stakeholders. And I would say that the sports companies, they are very keen to partner in developing the curriculum. And they want that they should be involved right from the beginning, rather than we design the curriculum and then ask them that now would you offer internship to our students. Sports law in one segment that we need to groom the students. Second is the sports tourism. Related to that, there are many aspects that are to be taught. And then how we manage an event. So related to that, the conceptual aspects. And many a times people venturing into sports, they do not know much about what are the different sports associations in India, how sports is organized, which are the premier ones. And sometimes they do not have that much of the passion for sports. So if you are making a career in sports management, you ought to develop a passion. The students can also be linked, you know, in some way with the research part, because teachers will also find that sports management, which is very less researched in India. So that is a segment they might be interested. And I tell you that once, you know, for 2-3 years, we do something producing students who are in sports management and we add up some new knowledge through the research papers, the companies would come themselves to you and ask for the consultancy projects, because this segment is emerging. I told you that imagine in 4 years, if the market doubles in India, then, you know, the kind of opportunities that are available, you cannot imagine at this juncture.
And last thing that I would like to tell is that we should always tell the student that India has the distinct advantages as far as sports management is concerned. One is that we have a huge population. So, the viewers which we have in India and the kind of interest they have. So, because of that, a lot of events, global events can be hosted in India. So, that is one strength why India can grow faster in sports management vis-a-vis the entire global sports industry is concerned. Second thing, Ankurji, is about the talent, the kind of talent that we have available. You know, if we can prove our talent in all the fields, automobiles, IT, etc., why not sports? So, we can definitely do better. Our infrastructure is also becoming better because the government of India schemes and all governments, Khelo India and many other things. And you see universities are given projects now to develop sports infrastructure. So, because of that, the kind of, I would say, the environment which is there, I haven't seen, you know, such kind of thing over the so many years, and that's the best time for us to grow. And organizations are very open towards networking. I mentioned about, you know, startups getting so much, you know, prominent. So, networking is, you know, doing networking is quite easier. So, the crux of what I spoke is that the opportunities for students are very good. And if we give them the right conceptual base and then handhold them and connect well with the corporate and the other stakeholders, then I think that the students who opt for sports management as a specialization, they will never be disappointed.
So, till now we have got some idea about the way in which we introduce sports management and the public policy and CSR for the benefit of our students. So, I am pretty sure you would think about, you know, introducing these specializations. The third very exciting field of specialization that we can think about, or the add-on course we can think about, is aviation. Now, remember that India is producing more women pilots than any other country, and now MBA aviation is quite gaining the momentum. So, in this backdrop, to know more about the program and what can be done, we have, as I mentioned earlier, Ms. Ankita Parikh. So, Ankitaji, would you like to mention something about the aviation?
Thank you, sir. Whenever someone says aviation or management or someone says aviation or airlines, everybody is thinking about that aviation is related with pilots only, or aviation is only related with the flying. But aviation is just not about the pilots or flying. Aviation is a management professional in aviation management. It stands out among other management specialization. Students get the opportunity to acquire the ability that would assist them to come up with the regular evolving industry. With a gigantic development in aviation industry, the specialization in aviation management is one of the upcoming trends that alerts the youngsters without fail for its notable living standards and fruitful jobs. MBA in aviation management personnel mostly work with the various national and international airline companies. Aviation management graduates are offered the job roles where they generally work outdoor, as they need to govern the various day-to-day operations of airline and airports. Most of them are placed with the ATCs, airlines, aircraft manufacturers, flight schools, and contractor under the private and public sector. They need to have a flexible work hours, as the aviation industry operates 24/7. It requires constant supervision of administration to inspect the working of various departments efficiently. The following are the few of the common job roles played by the MBAs in aviation management, like airport managers, HR manager, crew resource managements, CRMs, and aviation faculties, obviously, etc.
Now, the question is that what is your viewpoint about the current state of the aviation industry in India?
So, the civil aviation industry in India has emerged as one of the fastest growing industry in world, as well as India is currently considered the third largest civil aviation market in the world. India is expected to become the world's largest domestic civil aviation market in the next 10 to 15 years. India is also expected to displace the UK to become the third largest air passenger market by 2025. As well as India's passenger traffic grew at 16.52% year on year to 302 million in 2018, and its compound annual growth rate of 12.72% during financial year of 16 to 18. Government is also planning to invest around 1.83 billion for development of airport infrastructure along with the aviation navigation services by 2026. The government has 100% FDI allowed under the automatic route in schedule air transport services, as well as in the regional air transport services, and domestic scheduled passenger airlines. India's aviation industry is expected to witness 15.52 billion worth of investment in the next 5 years. The Indian government is also planning to invest around 1.83 billion for development of airport infrastructure along with the aviation navigation services. India's aviation industry is largely untapped with a huge growth opportunity, considering that the airport air transportation is still expensive for majority of the country's population, of which nearly 40% is a middle class. So the industry stakeholders should engage and collaborate with policymakers to implement efficient and rational decisions that would boost the India's civil aviation industry with the right policies. Focus on the quality, cost and passenger interest, India would be well placed to achieve its vision of becoming the third largest aviation market by 2025. As well as the current size of civil aviation industry is about $16 million, and it contribute around 0.5% of country's GDP. As well as a few of the factors that mainly lead to the transformation in the Indian aviation industries are like the entry of the growth of LCCs, the low-cost carriers just like Indigo, Air Asia, Vistara, SpiceJet. These are some low-cost carriers, as well as government also taking the initiative to develop the modernization in the airport, the PPP models, through the PPP models like the Delhi Airport, Terminal 3, Hyderabad Airport, as well as the Bengaluru Airport. These all airports are manufactured by the public-private partnership mode, as well as government also taking the initiative in policy making for support the air transportation industry as well as tourism industry. It also emphasizes on the regional connectivity, and in this government have taken one initiative, which is the Udaan scheme. As well as in this particular Udaan scheme, government emphasizes on the regional connectivity, and the few examples of these are Karina Airlines, Pavanans Airlines, some of the airlines which are largely connect the regional areas of India.
So, Ankita ji, I think you have brought up the very right aspects related to aviation management, and I feel that the number of airlines that are going up, and along with that the kind of promotion government of India is giving to the aviation sector. So, on account of that, we would find that there will be a lot of opportunities for students of MBA, and a lot of people at the ground staff will be required, the aviation support companies which are there, they would also require people. But at the same time, we have to ensure that we prepare the students for this. In again, I would come back to the model, that is the COIN model, and with that the things can really happen for the benefit of our students. And apart from that, just imagine that as more and more institutes in the time to come are going to offer aviation courses, whether as add-on or whether as a specialization, the number of teachers that would be required to teach these courses. So it's a new segment, which also some people who would be interested into academicians or the existing teachers who want to venture into this field, they can think about aviation management. And the research component, again, I would like to emphasize that very less research has happened related to aviation branding or related to the way in which the consumers behave in the aviation segment or the financial aspects, the logistics aspects. So that is one more area the management teachers can look forward to, not just research but also the consultancy in the time to come. So in this module, we have tried to give some kind of exposure taking up the three domains, public policy and CSR, sports management and aviation. And we are pretty sure that this will give you some food for thought to dwell upon the idea that whether these kind of courses can be introduced in the MBA program. And we hope that you found this module interesting, and thank you very much for joining us in this module.